Well, this week, a 10-point plan to tackle growing resistance to antibiotics has been welcomed by companies developing new types of drugs to tackle antimicrobial resistance. Well, Jim O'Neill, the chairman of the government body that prepared the report, said the cost of no action on the problem would be 10 million extra deaths at a cost of $100 trillion by 2050. Well, for his take on the report, we're joined by Neil Murray, Chief Executive of Redx Pharma. So Neil, your company is working to tackle all superbugs. So is this report effectively a fillip to your company?
It very much is. Jim and his team have done a fantastic job over the last 18 months that they've been looking at this very complex issue. And it's important now that the leadership that Jim has shown in this area is carried on by others to make sure that not just ourselves as a company, but the industry as a whole has the right framework to go forward and help solve what is a global crisis in terms of AMR.
So how many super bugs are there? Because, you know, you're working on a treatment to combat them all.
Well, we're working on multiple treatments because not all antibiotics will hit all different kinds of bacteria. So there are lots of different types of bacteria, and each of these bacteria can become resistant to different antibiotics. So you get multiple strains of infection that need to be tailored to a specific drug in terms of treating them. And that indeed is one of the challenges that we've had historically in the way that we use antibiotics. We've tried to take the sort of sledgehammer to crack a nut approach and use broad spectrum drugs that will hit a wide range of bacteria. What happens there is that those bacteria that you don't kill just develop resistance to that drug. What we need to do now going forwards is much more emphasis on diagnostic tools so that we understand specifically the bacterium that is causing the infection and then can then give an antibiotic that will kill that specific bacterium. And in that way, we extend the use of all antibiotics.
Okay, so, I mean, obviously there's a corporate opportunity, but this, as you said, is a global crisis. I mean, 10 million extra deaths, is that the tip of the iceberg?
Well, very much so, and the projections say that it's 10 million deaths a year by 2050, and that equates to one person every 3 seconds dying from resistant infection somewhere in the world, and that's quite a remarkable statistic, and indeed would make infectious deaths higher as a cause of death than cancer is today.
Now, going back to the report, there is a caveat in it. Pharma companies that apparently don't spend enough on developing new antibiotics will have to pay an annual surcharge. Does that apply to Redx in its current form? Might it apply to you?
Well, we're not a pharma company per se, we're a biotech company. So we're not interested, as we sit here today, in taking products all the way through to the marketplace. And the surcharge is aimed at companies that sell drugs directly to healthcare services worldwide. And the reason that I think that Jim has proposed that is there are two of many issues around this particular problem are to do with the supply of new drugs coming through, the amount of work that is being done by pharma companies researching those drugs, and at the other end of the spectrum, the way that companies get rewarded for the use of those drugs. Jim is trying to take a bit of a carrot and stick approach, I guess, in this situation where the carrot is come up with new commercial models that will reward companies better for bringing drugs to market. But the stick will be if companies don't get involved in antibiotic research, then effectively they would be taxed on their profits in order to fund that antibiotic research globally. Whether that's the right approach, only time will tell. I know that the industry as a whole has different views, different companies have different views. The key thing for both of those aspects, whether it's funding extra research or whether it's looking at new commercialization models, is that rapidly we reach a level of consensus amongst the industry players so that we have something that we can work on going forwards as a new model to promote more investment in antibacterials and bring more products to market.
Okay, well, it would be rude of me not to ask about industry players. You know, how are you doing in terms of negotiations with pharma partners?
Well, we continue to have negotiations with companies around our pipeline, and we're very confident that we'll secure further deals on our pipeline in due course. You know, the reason that we got into this area was because we anticipated, because of the nature of the problem and the severity of the problem, we anticipated more companies, large companies, coming back into the space, and that they would be looking for pipeline when they did come back into the space, and we wanted to be in a position where we had those pipeline assets that we could partner on with those companies. And we're very confident that in due course we would see further deal making around that.
Okay, now remind us about the pipeline of assets. Which ones are almost ready?
So we have a gram-positive program. Bacteria are split into two different types, if you like. There are gram-positive bacteria, which are slightly easier to kill, and gram-negative bacteria, which have got an extra membrane around the bacterium, which means that as a result, it's more difficult to get drugs in there to kill them. In the gram-positive space, we have a program that's progressing towards clinic for both MRSA infection, and also we're looking at gonorrhea infection, which is an increasing problem worldwide. And in the gram-negative space, we have programs that are looking at a range of bacterial infections there that are progressing very nicely. And the key thing about all of our antibacterial programs is that they're completely novel structures. So the big challenge we've had is that there hasn't been a new class of drugs come through in a generation. So 25, 30 years since we had the first new class of antibiotics. And our compounds represent potentially that first new class, and that's very exciting.
But time is of the essence.
I mean, absolutely.
We're obviously wanting you to hit targets as soon as possible, but in terms of this report, it took almost 3 years to research and to write. I'm wondering how long it will take for these recommendations to become effective, to be implemented.
Well, this comes back to the point about who's going to pick up the baton now that Jim and his team have done the excellent job that they have. And we need to see leadership globally to make sure that this isn't just another report that gets left on the shelf and nothing gets done about it. One of the things that Jim, I know, is very keen on is that leadership is provided either by the G7 or G20 nations. UK government is still committed to this space, and we need to make sure that leadership is maintained as we go forward.
They possibly might need your voice. Do you see yourself as a thought leader, and there's possibly a place for you in terms of this history that's been written?
I think my interest is particularly around Redx Pharma and securing value for our shareholders. That's my job. We're very keen on this area and in making sure that we get the right policies put forward, not just to solve the problem, but also to help the industry solve the problem. And we'll contribute to that as best we can.
Neil Murray, Chief Executive of Redx Pharma, thank you very much indeed for joining us today.
Thank you.